IVM.
Hi, I'm Satyajit.
Hi, I'm Rachita.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project.
We have as our guest today Mihir Mehta, investment banker at Ashika Capital. In this episode, we deep dive into The Intelligent Investor by Benjamin Graham.
In the second half, we also discuss The Little Book That Beats the Market by Joel Greenblatt, The Subtle Art of Not Giving a F*** by Manson, and One Up on Wall Street by Peter Lynch.
Mihir discusses the parameters for intelligent investment, the intrinsic value of a company, the market, success strategies in the financial market, and how to choose your f**ks wisely. This episode will help all listeners invest safely, highlight the importance of savings, and help manage finances prudently.
Happy listening.
The book Intelligent Investor was written by the founding father of value investing. So investing has always been taken sometimes as an art, sometimes as a science, sometimes as a mix of both. I think when Benjamin Graham, which was in the late 60s, wrote this book, and actually the principles stay pretty valid today as well, the idea was to lay the foundation of a particular investing style which would help new investors, novice investors, without relying on larger institutions or advisors who take away a large chunk of the gains that you make, and help them with certain guidelines, certain protocols when you are investing. So I started investing approximately, I guess, 7 to 8 years back, and that was the time that the first book that was recommended to me by a few investors was The Intelligent Investor, written in a very, very subtle and easygoing manner, which is useful to a layman and not essentially with someone having a accomplished background in investing. This book has had a lot of influence on the way I have invested, or on the way I would suggest everyone should invest, from principles of how to be a disciplined investor and not letting emotions come in your way of investing, to principles like why are we even investing in a company. So that entire thesis of starting from the very fact that why do we invest, going up to how should we invest, and allied protocols has definitely helped me invest much better.
Thank you, Mihir Mehta. That was about the book The Intelligent Investor by Benjamin Graham. We'll be right back after this to discuss the book in more detail.
Hi, my name is Anupam Gupta. I'm B50 on Twitter. I am the host of Paisa Paisa, the show that talks money. On my show, I speak to experts from every field of money and finance, from stock markets, equities, debt funds, credit cards, life insurance, every possible area of money and finance that you can think of. We even did an episode on cryptocurrency. I've got fantastic guests from mutual funds to personal finance experts everywhere, robo-advisory, startups, just name it, we've got it. At Paisa Paisa, we help you make smart decisions about money. You work hard for money, now make your money work hard for you. New episodes out every Monday, and you can listen to my show on the IVM podcast app or any other podcasting app that you have. Paisa Paisa is brought to you by Paytm Money.
Welcome to Paperback by the Open Library Project. I am your co-host Satyajit, otherwise known as Onion Knight in most food circles. I'm hosting this podcast with my co-founder at the Open Library Project, Rachita Sharma.
Hi guys, my name is Rachita and I'm an ex-banker who gave up my banking profession to follow my passion and run libraries across the world. The Open Library Project is a non-fiction book library service offered to businesses on a subscription basis. We're trying to move away from the run-of-the-mill library concept by setting up rotational and locational curated libraries at co-working spaces, corporates, and business incubators. The idea here is to create value, build a knowledge community, and encourage a growth mindset amongst our members.
Today we have with us on the show Mihir Mehta, an investment banker from Ashika Capital. Mihir worked at Google before moving into the investment banking space. He is also the founder of FinTuned. Welcome to the show, Mihir.
Thank you.
It's lovely to have you on the show.
Thank you so much.
And that excerpt was a very good summary of the book. So we'll start with probably talking about the basic rules that the book talks about. Now, why I think this book is really special is because, you know, Warren Buffett is considered a benchmark in the investment industry. And this was like his guru who wrote this book, Benjamin Graham. And he talks about, like you said, very relevant things which are pertinent even in investing today. For example, is, you know, the tips that he gives to, like, what you should see in a company when you're investing in them. Like, for example, one point that he says is that you have to see the current value of a company as opposed to, you know, what its intrinsic value will be in the future, which is based on, say, the values of the company or the growth. So, you know, tell us, say, one or two tips from the book that, you know, you really like stand by while investing.
No, that's actually an interesting point. So, in fact, Warren Buffett had, because you mentioned that Warren Buffett mentioned that this is, and he's in fact said that this is one of the books that every investor
should read
before starting investing should read. He was so profoundly impacted by Graham that he named his son after him. So that's an interesting fact. And the book doesn't really give tips. What it gives are fundamentals, principles, protocols, however you want to define it as.
Right.
I think a couple of things that have, there are multiple principles that the book talks about, but two of them, which I think are very relevant to the current way investors come in and invest, is one that invest in a company like you own it and not just for capital gains or speculation. What that essentially means is that today, where there is a big gap between the management and the investors of the company, especially when you look at Indian companies.
Right.
So when in the early heydays of investing, the entire idea of investing was to invest in a company which you understand and as an investor and which you would like to run as a business. So this has particularly changed in today's scenario because of, you know, consistent tips, consistent you know, calls and so on and so forth being generated by people who may or may not even own the company.
Yeah.
And so what Benjamin Graham advised against very strictly was to not just rely on these tips or these calls, but to invest with the motive that you want to invest in a company where you would love to run the business if
like
given a chance.
Believe in the company's purpose.
Exactly.
And you're not just investing because you think it's profitable.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that is one of the things that something that has been my guiding principle. So that I invest in businesses which I understand and not just from a financial gain perspective. One of the other things that he actually says is that, I mean, you need not really be a smart investor. You just need to be a disciplined investor.
Mm-hmm.
Markets across the globe today are very volatile and they get impacted with a lot of, you know, information coming in from governments, from financial institutions, from you know, and multiple other sources. And today, unlike the days when he wrote the book, there are many and more channels which propagate information. So all the more required in today's world that any investor maintains the discipline of staying invested and does not let emotion overrule his investment decision. Because as I mentioned, unlike the early days, today an investor is bombarded with information from multitudinous sources, which you know, makes you emotional, makes you question your decision again and again. But and that is where this the need of the hour is that the investor stays disciplined, does not become emotional when you know he's taking either an entry or an exit to the company.
Right.
So how does one separate the emotional part of it from the financial part of it? Because you know, we do get sort of attached to our investments, or we do continue even in bad investments, hoping against hope sometimes that the company may turn around. So how would you suggest that, how does the book suggest that we deal with that?
So one of the things that the book talks about is in terms of being strictly technical. So from a value perspective, from an earnings growth perspective, from, you know, the leverage perspective, there are obviously financial indicators which tell you. So like today in
also
any...
Also the history of the company, I believe.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yeah. So there are financial indicators that always tell you that whether, you know, is the company a great investment or is it failing most of the checkpoints. So today with any thing in life, right? Where you have indicators, and if you were running your own business, so once you feel that you're running your own business, you start taking those indicators seriously. So what the book says is that once you have defined your set of financial indicators, which you will use or which you're going to use to judge the company, stick to it. And when the company starts scoring below a certain parameter, which you have envisioned for yourself on that spreadsheet or on that paper or however, I think it's time to exit the company and not stay attached, because you may hope that the company may turn better, but the moment it, you know, is not fulfilling at least say 6 to 7 out of your 10 indicators, it's not something that you should hold on to and look for a better, newer opportunity which the market may offer. So I think maintaining those parameters which you have made for yourself is something that you can rely on. And second, I think till the time your belief in the business stays consistent. So, I mean, to give you a very, very quick example, as 20 years back for Warren Buffett, Coca-Cola was a massive investment and a great investment at that. Today, the world has evolved. Today, across the globe, there is a constant wave of healthy, alternatives, beverages. So now, obviously, that thesis, which was there, where Coca-Cola was being used as a replacement for water, has gone out with the changing psychology or changing preferences of people. So, yes, there you have to be mature enough to understand
when to exit,
understand that this business may not hold true for the next 20 years, what it was. So that is where, I mean, even Warren Buffett made a statement that, you know, he may and he will soon exit that investment, because with changing times, he doesn't see the relevance of the company holding still and the potential holding still. So those are the things that you take into account.
Right. So you mentioned parameters that you list. So do you do this as an exercise yourself when you're investing in for yourself? Or
yeah, absolutely.
Company?
Absolutely.
So, and are the parameters different for every company? Are the metrics the same that you list down?
No, metrics and the thresholds are the same.
Okay.
It may differ with the industry that the company is operating in. Yeah. So, for instance, to give you a very quick example, when we invest, so at a portfolio level, one of the essential parameters that I see is return on assets. Mm. Now, when I look at my business, for instance, or any service-led business, a return on assets may not be the most relevant parameter because it's not an asset-heavy business. But when I look at a company like Bajaj, when I look at a company which has been in that space where it has a massive manufacturing capacity, is the company being able to rotate its assets efficiently? Mm. So that is something that, you know, determines how to use parameters industry wise. But yes, overall, we do have a guiding principle that, again, to give you a very quick example, in my personal portfolio, I have maintained a discipline unless until there are exceptions always. While you go by the book, there are always exceptions. But for me, having a company which has a trailing price earnings multiple of more than 24, 25 is an expensive company.
Okay.
So whether the company has massive growth prospect, I would still shy away from that because it is extremely expensive.
Right.
So, and as I said, unless the exception deserves so, I would not go ahead and invest in that company. So yeah, these are some of the parameters that we maintain, and we have our thresholds for every parameter that I mentioned. And that's how we select or eliminate companies.
Okay. What do you think the risk appetite of an intelligent investor should be like? Because the book talks about a point that, you know, you should never trust Mr. Market, which is basically that, you know, the market is ever changing, and no matter what you have envisioned for your company is always going to be, you know, dependent on how the market is reacting. So what do you think, you know, like the risk appetite of an intelligent investor should be like?
So here's how I would like to answer this. So it's like this, right? When you buy a house, are you looking to sell? No.
No.
You're looking to stay in it.
Right.
So my risk appetite is just a function of how emotional I am with that investment. So if I'm buying a house where I ultimately am looking to sell, right, and not believing that I'm owning that business because I believe this business will do really well, then I think as a thumb rule, even in that situation, from a value investing perspective, I mean, and that's what I advise my friends and people who ask me about investing is that if you really put money in an asset which you want to exit, do not look at that asset for at least 5 years. Mm-hmm. That is like a minimum time for a company to run through multiple business cycles and give
much
you that
like
kind of
mutual funds also.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But if you have invested in a company which you totally believe in, I think the entire thing of risk appetite is as much as that promoter is taking.
Right.
So his risk appetite is infinite.
Yours. Yeah.
Is the same as I would take if I'm investing in the business from that belief.
Right. Great. So risk appetite is a personal choice. It depends on the personal investor itself. On that note, we're going to take a short break and we'll be right back after this.
Hello, 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 everybody. Welcome to another awesome week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you are not following us on social media, please make sure you do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. You know, the IPL has been going full board this week or for the last couple of weeks. If you podcast around that, we got a couple of suggestions for you. There is a new show that we've launched called What a Player. It's being hosted by Akash Mehta, the host of Vartalab, and Siddharth Dudeja, who is a really funny stand-up comic. Also, on Cyrus Says, we've been doing this Wednesday episode called Lanso, Left Arm Not So Orthodox. On that, Cyrus is talking to a variety of different people about what happened the previous week in cricket. And if you want to get a historical perspective on what T20 cricket is and how it's come about, you might want to check out the show we did a couple of years ago called The Cricketwala Chronicles. It's hosted by Ayaz Memon, and in the first season, Ayaz examines how T20 cricket started. And speaking of the action this week, on the seen and the unseen, Amit Verma's guest is the economics editor of the Hindu, Pooja Mehra. The two of them talk about how the Indian economy has struggled in the past decade under two separate governments and prime ministers. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam is joined by Dhaval Kapadia, director, portfolio specialist at Morningstar. They talk about how you can assess your financial goals in the new financial year. On IVM Likes, Abhineet, Zoya, Madhuri and Radhika, the newbies, give out pop culture recommendations and later take you on a nostalgic journey of 90s pop music. Just so you know, the playlist of 90s songs that they recommended, we're going to make those available on our social media. On our Marathi podcast, Golgappa, Tripti is joined by animal whisperer Anand Shinde, who narrates fascinating stories of human-animal interaction and lays emphasis on the preservation of wildlife. On the Filter Coffee podcast, Karthik Nagarajan is joined by media and creative consultant Ramesh Srivats. They talk about cricket, learning JavaScript, and how Ramesh rose to fame on Twitter. And with that, let's get you on with your show.
Welcome back. We still have with us Mihir Mehta, an investment banker. So the next book that we're going to talk about is The Little Book That Meets the Market by Joel Greenblatt. So Mihir, tell us about this book. Why did this book stand out for you?
So the reason, Joel has very well, so there are, let me tell you before I begin my answer that there are more than, I guess, 500 books on investing.
Right.
A lot of these books talk to you about the emotion involved in investing. They talk to you about fundamentals of investing. Mm. And very few of these books actually give you the actual mantra for investing. Right. When I say that, what I mean is today is like this, that you may learn everything of something, but when it comes to implementation of that principle, that book may not actually talk to you about how to implement whatever has been said about investing. Mm. The Little Book That Beats the Market Every Time actually is a very, very concise, precise book which gives you the formula for, as per Joel, the right formula for picking companies, or at least, if not picking companies, starting to pick companies.
Right.
So when a novice investor comes to the market, there are, if I look at the Indian markets, for instance, there are more than 8,000 listed companies, right? And how do you really know which company to even research on?
Yeah.
Right.
Most of the investors then choose either a financial advisor or a mutual fund, because it's the lack of understanding where to start, which is where this book helps.
Okay.
Because the formula that has been given in this book can really help you select your first level of companies to start initiating research on, and I think that is something that is why this book has stood out for me, because it is just does not talk about the theoretics of it, but actually goes on to tell you how to implement it.
Yeah. And I think to a large extent, it's also on the principles of Benjamin Graham's values
Absolutely.
On investing. So,
absolutely. Yeah.
So great. A great book for novice investors. If you're looking out to start off investing, I think it's something that may help.
It gives you the mathematical formula for it.
Yeah. So this, in fact, this book has, while it adopts the principles of value investing, it actually tells you what number to pick and what parameter to pick. So for an investor, you know, it's like how a child is, right? So you can give them the significance of you know, why alphabets exist and so on and so forth. But if he cannot put that in a sentence, it's futile.
Right.
This book tells you how to put it in that sentence.
Yeah, perfect. Sounds fascinating. So the next book we're moving on to is One Up on Wall Street by John Rothschild and Peter Lynch. So Mihir, tell us a little about this book.
So One Up on Wall Street is a book, again, is a book that left a profound impact on me, because the previous two books that I've mentioned were books that were actually written by authors / investors who never worked in a corporate structure.
Okay.
This was written by someone by the name, obviously, Peter Lynch was the lead author. He was the fund manager for Fidelity. Mm-hmm. And as a fund manager of Fidelity, his performance beat the benchmark indices at that point in time. The reason I'm saying that this book and the author is different is because being within that corporate atmosphere where you have to run a fund to please investors, mm-hmm. as well as to adhere to certain norms of investing, is a challenging and a daunting task. Peter in that fared really well. And some of the principles actually build on Graham's principles of value investing.
Right.
But as I mentioned, when you are in turbulent times and when you're running or when you're managing other people's money, life can really get tough on you. Because if it's 10 points hard to maintain your own emotion with your own money, it's 100 points harder to maintain your emotion with someone else's money.
Right.
So Peter was able to do that very successfully by adopting these principles for over 16 years, post which it was discovered that the return delivered by Fidelity actually beat the benchmark indices by more than 200 basis points. So that's why this book has been a good learning.
I really love about the book is, so I have worked briefly in the securities market with Kotak Securities, and it was the, I would say, unfortunate time when the subprime crisis happened. And that's like, you know, when you are owning other people's money, and I can understand those stress levels. And what I really like is that he's actually using his success strategies as examples and explaining them in a very non-financial manner, which is very easy for anybody to understand.
Absolutely.
So definitely, you know, worth a read, I would say.
Yeah.
And the final book that we're moving on to today is The Subtle Art of Not Giving a F*** by Mark Manson, one of our favorite books of the last year, I think. I know almost everyone I know who's a reader has read this book, and it's had a phenomenal impact on most of the people who've read it. So Mihir, tell us a little about what impact it had on you, or why you like this book so much.
So I think, you know, as an investment banker, so the reason I really love this book is because more than investing or more than anything else, it has helped me think right as an investment banker. So,
as a human,
yes, but really, absolutely. I mean, yeah, because your job is just a successor to what you are as a person. So yes, overall, yes, as a human. But even on my job, I think what we realize is that investment banker, to be very honest, is a glorified sales guy. So he's just not selling door to door, or he's just not selling, you know, telling people to buy the next best pen. But yeah, again, his job is to make a pitch. A lot of times what happens as salespeople, we get demotivated. We think, oh, nothing is coming our way. Things are not turning up as I would want to be. And in my life, for instance, at a point in time, if I'm running mandates for 25 to 30 companies, hardly ever closes for a year. So in those times, you really have to keep your patience and motivation high, because while you may feel that things are not coming through, you know, will it ever come through? And why can't I just, and those thoughts stay with you and can really hamper your work patience. So I think, so this book has given me that perspective that, you know, you need to start ignoring, or you need to start taking things in a much positive manner. So they may
be, you know, the amazing bit is he says, don't be too positive also. You know, own it. Like, you're in a bad space, own it.
Own
like, you know,
it.
My
Correct.
Life is going bad. Like, you don't have to be, like, most self-help books are overly positive, and it's very easy to be saying that.
Correct.
But to implement it in a hard time is really difficult. So I like that he says, you know, take some time out, accept what you're going through, and then decide how many want to give.
Yeah.
So,
correct.
In fact, negative thoughts are such a big part of our makeup,
of our
right?
Daily
you can't
absolutely.
Avoid them. You can just find better ways to moderate them and not let them affect your life. So that's where this
book... absolutely. And that has been very helpful to me personally over the last 1 year because, you know, as investment bankers, the first question we get asked is how many deals have closed? And, you know, when you don't really have an answer, it more than embarrassing, it's like a reflection as to why did this not happen. And that's
the gestation
where you,
periods are really long. So.
Yeah, they are really long. Yeah. So we are very open about the fact, yes, we didn't close deals and so did many other people may not have. But today we know that what we're doing is right. And if not today, it may soon happen tomorrow. So I think accepting that fact that not always things have to be hunky-dory has really helped me and the team in you know, keeping that motivation on.
Yeah. Also, like, you know, he mentions that you should not have anything with, like, you should not think about anything with certainty, like that, for example, I'm not a runner. A lot of people say, you know, oh, I'm not this kind of a person or I'm not that kind of a person. But what I love about Mark Manson is he says that, you know, there's nothing that you are not. So, you know, if you're not a runner, it's because you don't get up and go run.
Correct.
So the minute you start it, you will become that person.
Right.
So stating that, oh, I'm not a morning person or I'm not a runner is not the way that you go with life. So, yeah, it really brings out that very relevant, you know, facts.
No, absolutely. I agree. And yeah, so it reminds me of the time when and there was this very little story on Napoleon that when he was, I think, getting into Russia or somewhere, I forget the exact story, but he told his soldiers that there is no mountain, guys. I mean, you know, so they were very worried because we are not climbers. So he just asked them, where's the mountain? And they said there, and he kept saying that, no, I can't see it. You start walking, it's a normal road.
Yeah.
You may just feel that it's uphill, but that's about it. It's not a mountain. So I think, yeah, that attitude that, okay, I'm not, you know, this or I cannot do this really brings you in that negative space even before you start doing something.
Shift
in perspective.
It restricts your growth.
Yeah. If you can shift your perspective to look at things maybe a little more optimistically, you may start doing a lot more things.
Yeah, absolutely. So I completely agree. I think that's something that we have tried to follow because for instance, this team was something that we started. So I don't come from an investment banking background at all. So for me, it was a complete change from a marketing to a finance background. So yeah, I mean, I used to think that it is difficult, but once you start, everything at the heart of it is something similar.
Yes.
Right? So.
Great advice. That's great advice for anyone to pick up this book. You know, I myself have personally given this book as a gift to so many people.
Yeah,
because
absolutely.
It's just had such a profound impact on my life. And yeah,
great.
One final question on the show is that what are your reading habits? Do you prefer to read physical books? Do you read on the Kindle? What is it like for you?
Oh no, I am more of a physical books person. I cannot really do Kindle. But I do read a lot of stuff on my phone.
Okay.
But it's like, you know, yeah, books I prefer physical because it's just the way I think I've been brought up. So difficult to change certain things. But yeah.
So thank you, Mihir Mehta, for being with us on the show today. And we look forward to having you again. And a big thank you to all our listeners. You can follow the Open Library Project on LinkedIn, Instagram and Facebook for latest updates on our events. And stay tuned for the next Paperback podcast on IVM Podcasts. Happy reading. You can follow IVM Podcast on Facebook, Instagram and Twitter at IVM Podcasts. Happy listening.
Did you know that Parsis in Mumbai, instead of being left at the Tower of Silence after they die, are now cremated? And why? Because a cow fell sick in the early 1990s. Did you know that the smog in Delhi is caused by something that farmers in Punjab do and that there's no way to stop them? Did you know that there wasn't one gas tragedy in Bhopal, but three? One of them was seen, but two were unseen. Did you know that many well-intentioned government policies hurt the people they're supposed to help? Why was demonetization a bad idea? How should GST have been implemented? Why are all our politicians so corrupt when not all of them are bad people? I'm Amit Verma, and in my weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen, I take a shot at answering all these questions and many more. I aim to go beyond the scene and show you the unseen effects of public policy and private action. I speak to experts on economics, political philosophy, cognitive neuroscience, and constitutional law so that their insights can blow not only my mind, but also yours. The Seen and the Unseen releases every Monday. So do check out the archives and follow the show at seenunseen.in. You can also subscribe to The Seen and the Unseen on whatever podcast app you happen to prefer.
You say jogging, and I'm telling you a story about a man who dated three sisters. You say boss, kurla, and it's about a guy who went out to a party where they were selling beef. This is Anand Sivkumaran, aka The Croc. My show, The Croc's Tales. You give me a word, I'll tell you a story. Words aapke, kahani aapke liye. Do tune in on Monday and Thursday on the IVM website, app, and anywhere you get your podcast from.